Book talk begins at 8:13. Welcome to CraftLit, the podcast for crafters who love books. My name is Heather Ordover, and I'm podcasting from where the Delaware River meets the Old York Road, New Hope, Pennsylvania. Episode 612, Brinklit. This episode of CraftLit is brought to you by its listeners. Well, hello. How are you? I am well. I had a great birthday. Thank you all for all the lovely birthday wishes. It was fun. Andrew surprised me by taking me to a storefront not too far from here called The Uncorked Artist. And we walked in the door and all my mom friends from here jumped out from behind a sliding door and said, surprise. And we all sat around and painted for a couple of hours, drinking wine and eating cheese. And it was lovely. We had a really good time. It was very, very non-pressurized art creation. It's a super smart idea. And the woman who taught us how to paint our Delaware River Gap masterpieces, as you would imagine, she was just lovely. Tara was. So Andrew wins. That was great. But the second thing, and the reason for the name of this episode, Brinklit, is Andrew's other gift to me was from a Kickstarter that he found a year ago. It took them quite a while to get their act together. And when this gift arrived, I could see why. It is a beautifully designed little boxed set of literary tarot cards. And at first I thought, oh, well, that's kind of cute. And yeah, it is. But what was really, really awesome, and I've tried to scan a couple of these to put into the show notes. A lot of these books, not surprisingly, are CraftLit books. And three cards that I picked out to scan to share with you guys so that you can see just how magnificent the art is. And the PS to that is this whole thing is done in heavy gold leaf. So they're the scan toned down the gold leaf. These cards are very sparkly and very easy to read. But the first one for the Chariot, the book that they picked was Treasure Island, which is great because it's all about motion and it's about movement and it's about going into the next adventure. The Hermit, genius move here, is the creature from Frankenstein. And the art is heartbreaking and beautiful and very wise. Justice is Edmond Dantes. And this one I'm going to try and describe to you because it is just so smartly designed. The picture is of Edmond Dantes in his stone cell, young Edmond, and there's a stone that's been pulled out towards the back of the cell, and you can see the gray-haired man looking through at him. Dantes is sitting on the floor, despondent, holding balance scales in one hand and looking kind of mournfully down towards us. And on the floor between him and us, there is a puddle of water. And in that puddle of water, reflected, is him dressed all fancy schmancy, holding a gun, pointing it at the people who destroyed his life. I mean, yeah, baby. That is what we talk about, the power of literature. Just to be able to speak volumes about the human condition and what it means to be just. And all of that that gets wrapped up in both in this situation, a beautifully succinct piece of art that is only able to be a beautifully succinct piece of art because we know the book. I love it. I have never seen anything that so completely sums up why CraftLit than this box of literary tarot cards. I think you can still order them, but the reason, going back to the reason why I named it this, is because the group of people that put this box of tarot cards together is Brink Literacy Project. And they're all about spreading literacy in places that are underserved. And I really, 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 really admire what they're doing and wanted to support them. So shout out to them. They're not sponsoring this or anything. I just, please go visit their website, take a look at what they're doing, and take a look at these amazing cards. Wow. The next thing that I wanted to share with you, I don't know if you saw it over on Instagram, Barbara Kingsolver, who I grew up going camping with when we were all living in Arizona, Barbara Kingsolver just released her first knitting pattern that goes with her book, The Lacuna. And I was so excited. So I pinged her and she wrote back and it was lovely. She remembers me being a little kid, which it's been so long, made me unreasonably happy somehow. But yes, go take a look at the pattern. It's beautiful. Their mitts, the colors are just spectacular and exactly what you would expect from a book that has Frida Kahlo in it. So there's that. Paper sizing. I have a question for y'all. If you've made handmade paper, you know, just blenderizing recycled paper, if you've made handmade paper before, have you sized it? And if you have sized it, have you sized it internally by putting something like gelatin or glue into the paper pulp, splooshy stuff? Or did you size it after by painting the paper with gelatin or something? And if you've done both, which do you think worked better? I guess it would be better for two different reasons. One would be better for writing, and then the other would be better for painting or arting on. So that's my question to you. Paper sizing, yes or no? Paper sizing, which kind? From what materials? There's a lot of questions in there. And of course, if you've never made paper before, well, I'm done with that part. So now we're moving on to getting around to the book. The book today is fun. Today we have two chapters, The Antechamber of Monsieur de Treville and The Audience. Chapter 2 and chapter 3 have some complicated subtextual conversating happening in here. And the part that makes it complicated is that it's all supposed to be really funny. And it is if the reader of the text is able to put the correct emphasis on the right syllable. While our LibriVox reader is lovely and has a voice that's easy to listen to, he does not have such an easy time with these two chapters. And so I went searching and I found there is another narrated version by Tantor Media, T-A-N-T-O-R. There's a link to this in the show notes. Tantor Media, it was, let's see, narrated by John Lee, J-O-H-N-L-E-E, just what you'd expect. He was quite good. And while you can get this on Audible, if you don't want to spend the money or the credit on it, I was able to find this on my digital library. You know how libraries have digital apps that they use now, like Hoopla or Libby, if you're lucky? We aren't. We have Hoopla. I was able to find this version on my library's Hoopla app. So it is possible. If it is even remotely possible for you to listen to today's chapters somewhere else, that would be great. And Eric and I will give you two time codes today. The time code that you already heard when book talk begins. And before we start playing the chapter audio, we will give you another time code for when you could fast wind through the chapters here and pop back in for, you know, post-game commentary. I just wanted to let you know that. Heads up. But that being said, there aren't that many things that I need to prep you for today, except what I've already said. There's some fun. It's almost slapstick, actually, especially at the beginning of chapter 3. I was trying to figure out which comedy routine it made me think of. And at first I was thinking, oh, it's John Belushi with the beer can on his forehead. And then I thought, no, it's not really Animal House. I mean, it sort of is Animal House. And then I thought, oh, maybe it's Who's On First, because there's some kind of fun wordplay that goes on in our chapters today. And then I thought, no, actually, I think it's Eric Idle in Monty Python and the Holy Grail in this scene.
Make sure the prince doesn't leave this room until I come and get him.
Not to leave the room, even if you come and get him.
No, until I come and get him.
Until you come and get him, we're not to enter the room.
No, you stay in the room and make sure he doesn't leave.
And you'll come and get him.
Right.
We don't need to do anything apart from just stop him entering the room.
No. Leaving the room.
Leaving the room, yes.
All right?
Right. Oh,
look, it's quite simple. You just stay here and make sure he doesn't leave the room. All right?
Oh, I remember. Can he leave the room with us?
No. You just keep him in here and make sure...
Oh, yes, we'll keep him in here, obviously. But if he had to leave and we weren't with him...
Just keep him in here...
Until you or anyone else...
No, not anyone else, just me.
Just you.
Get back. Right?
Right, we'll stay here until you get back.
And make sure he doesn't leave.
What?
Make sure he doesn't leave.
So, I don't know. You can tell me after you've listened to the chapters if you agree or not. I'm having a hard time pinning down exactly what scene this is ringing bells in my head about. But at least you got to listen to a little Python, so that's not bad. One thing to note, there's a reference to the League. This was an official kind of a Star Chamber thing. It was Catholics defending themselves against the Calvinists, and Henri IV did away with it. Heraldry. We often come across descriptions of heraldry, and the language and the code of heraldry is fascinating, but I'm just going to give you the short notes version, which is this. Fidelis et fortis is faithful and strong. And this is the heraldic honor that was given to Treville by the king, current king, Louis XIII, Louis the Just. It's a golden lion walking to the right. He's got his right forepaw up. And it's just mentioned here as a way to reinforce that Treville is a really stand-up guy. We are not to ascribe him any ill motives, and we are to respect his read of a situation. He doesn't fly off the handle. He doesn't, you know, see snipers underneath every mattress. That's a really weird way to put it, Heather. He's not suspicious for no reason. There is a reference to foils, as in fencing foils, being buttoned. This is, they'd have a button put on the top of it so that they would be blunted, is probably what we would say now. If you were just playing around, you would want to have your foils blunted so that you didn't hurt people, she said, giving hints. If you hear a long list of names, It starts with Besme, I think. That's a list of famous assassins or assassins that were known at the time of the writing of this book. And it kind of doesn't mean anything. It's not one of those moments where Dumas is kind of playing a joke on us and getting all meta. There is a reference in here to Cardinal Richelieu having a mistress, which of course is interesting because it seems like everybody knew. The other part of it is there's another woman's name who's mentioned who was his niece, who he also may have been doing stuff with. I'm still looking into this. Richelieu is a fascinating character and very complicated, but it's France, maybe, is the answer. I don't know. I'm going to keep looking into that for you. And that's about it, I think. I'm looking at my notes. Oh, there is a funny thing that Dumas does on accident. He mentions D'Artagnan feeling like Gulliver in the second part of Gulliver's Travels, where he goes to visit the Brobdingnagians, the giants, and he feels like really off his game because they're giant and he isn't. When D'Artagnan was alive, as far as this book goes, Jonathan Swift hadn't been born yet. Gulliver's Travels hadn't been written for another 100 years. So that's Dumas just giving us a reference point that we would understand, not necessarily one that D'Artagnan would have had access to. So there's that. And the rest of everything is just listen to guys doing guy things for 2 chapters today. I'll talk more about that on the flip side. But yeah, we get some interesting perspectives into how the King's Guard works as the King's Guard, but also how our 3 musketeers, Porthos, who we meet first, Aramis, who we meet second, and Athos, who we meet third, how they all relate to each other and how they're almost archetypal guys. It's going to be interesting. All right. Here we go with chapters 2 and 3 of The 3 Musketeers. Written by Alexandre Dumas and read for us by John Lee. And if you wanted to go listen to this book elsewhere and come back for the post-game commentary, just come back and fast wind to 1 hour, 11 minutes, and 58 seconds.
The antechamber of Monsieur de Treville. Monsieur de Treville, as his family was still called in Gascony, or Monsieur de Treville, as he has ended by styling himself in Paris, had really commenced life as D'Artagnan now did, that is to say, without a sou in his pocket, but with a fund of audacity, shrewdness, and intelligence, which makes the poorest Gascon gentleman often derive more in his hope from the paternal inheritance than the richest Perigordian or Barachon gentleman derives in reality from his. His insolent bravery, his still more insolent success at a time when blows poured down like hail, had borne him to the top of that difficult ladder called court favor, which he had climbed 4 steps at a time. He was the friend of the king, who honored highly, as everyone knows, the memory of his father, Henry IV. The father of Monsieur de Treville had served him so faithfully in his wars against the League that in default of money, a thing to which the Béarnais was accustomed all his life, and who constantly paid his debts with that of which he never stood in need of borrowing, that is to say, with ready wit. In default of money, we repeat, he authorized him, after the reduction of Paris, to assume for his arms a golden lion passant upon gules, with the motto, Fideles et Fortis. This was a great matter in the way of honor, but very little in the way of wealth, so that when the illustrious companion of the great Henry died, the only inheritance he was able to leave his son was his sword and his motto. Thanks to this double gift and the spotless name that accompanied it, Monsieur de Treville was admitted into the household of the young prince, where he made such good use of his sword and was so faithful to his motto that Louis XIII one of the good blades of his kingdom, was accustomed to say that if he had a friend who was about to fight, he would advise him to choose a second, himself first, and Tréville next, or even perhaps before himself. Thus, Louis XIII had a real liking for Tréville, a royal liking, a self-interested liking, it is true, but still a liking. At this unhappy period, it was an important consideration to be surrounded by such men as Tréville. Many might take for their device the epithet strong, which formed the second part of his motto, but very few gentlemen could lay claim to the faithful, which constituted the first. Tréville was one of these latter. His was one of those rare organizations endowed with an obedient intelligence like that of the dog, with a blind valor, a quick eye, and a prompt hand, to whom sight appeared only to be given to see if the king were dissatisfied with anyone, and the hand to strike this displeasing personage, whether a Besme, a Moraviers, a Piltio de Mer, or a Vitry. In short, up to this period, nothing had been wanting to Tréville but opportunity. But he was ever on the watch for it, and he faithfully promised himself that he would not fail to seize it by its three hairs whenever it came within reach of his hand. At last, Louis XIII made Tréville the captain of his musketeers, who were to Louis XIII in devotedness, or rather in fanaticism, what his ordinaries had been to Henry III and his Scotch guard to Louis XI. On his part, the cardinal was not behind the king in this respect. When he saw the formidable and chosen body with which Louis XIII had surrounded himself, this second, or rather this first king of France, became desirous that he too should have his guard. He had his musketeers, therefore, as Louis XIII had his, and these two powerful rivals vied with each other in procuring not only from all the provinces of France, but even from all foreign states, the most celebrated swordsmen. It was not uncommon for Richelieu and Louis XIII to dispute over their evening game of chess upon the merits of their servants. Each boasted the bearing and the courage of his own people, while exclaiming loudly against duels and brawls, they excited them secretly to quarrel, deriving an immoderate satisfaction or genuine regret from the success or defeat of their own combatants. We learn this from the memoirs of a man who was concerned in some few of these defeats, and in many of these victories. Tréville had grasped the weak side of his master, and it was to this address that he owed the long and constant favor of a king who has not left the reputation behind him of being very faithful in his friendships. He paraded his musketeers before the Cardinal Armand du Plessis with an insolent air, which made the gray mustache of his eminence curl with ire. Tréville understood admirably the war method of that period, in which he who could not live at the expense of the enemy must live at the expense of his compatriots. His soldiers formed a legion of devil-may-care fellows, perfectly undisciplined toward all but himself. Loose, half-drunk, imposing, the king's musketeers, or rather, Monsieur de Tréville's, spread themselves about in the cabarets, in the public walks, and the public sports, shouting, twisting their mustaches, clanking their swords, and taking great pleasure in annoying the guards of the cardinal whenever they could fall in with them, then drawing in the open streets as if it were the best of all possible sports, sometimes killed, but sure in that case to be both wept and avenged, often killing others, but then certain of not rotting in prison, Monsieur de Tréville being there to claim them. Thus, Monsieur de Tréville was praised to the highest note by these men, who adored him, and who, ruffians as they were, trembled before him like scholars before their master, obedient to his least word, and ready to sacrifice themselves to wash out the smallest insult. Monsieur de Tréville employed this powerful weapon for the king in the first place, and the friends of the king, and then for himself and his own friends. For the rest, in the memoirs of this period, which has left so many memoirs, one does not find this worthy gentleman blamed even by his enemies, and he had many such among men of the pen as well as among men of the sword. In no instance, let us say, was this worthy gentleman accused of deriving personal advantage from the cooperation of his minions. Endowed with a rare genius for intrigue, which rendered him the equal of the ablest intriguers, he remained an honest man. Still further, in spite of sword thrusts which weaken and painful exercises which fatigue, he had become one of the most gallant frequenters of the revels, one of the most insinuating ladies' men, one of the softest whisperers of interesting notes of his day. The bonnes fortunes of de Tréville were talked of as those of Monsieur de Bassompierre, and had been talked of 20 years before, and that was not saying a little. The captain of the musketeers was therefore admired, feared, and loved, and this constitutes the zenith of human fortune. Louis XIV absorbed all the smaller stars of his court in his own vast radiance, but his father, a son pluribus impar, left his personal splendor to each of his favorites, his individual value to each of his courtiers. In addition to the levies of the king and the cardinal, there might be reckoned in Paris at that time more than 200 smaller, but still noteworthy levies. Among these 200 levies, that of Tréville was one of the most sought. The court of his hotel, situated in the Rue de Vieux Colombier, resembled a camp from by 6 o'clock in the morning in summer and 8 o'clock in winter. From 50 to 60 musketeers who appeared to replace one another, in order always to present an imposing number, paraded constantly, armed to the teeth and ready for anything. On one of those immense staircases upon whose space modern civilization would build a whole house, ascended and descended the office-seekers of Paris, who ran after any sort of favor, gentlemen from the provinces anxious to be enrolled, and servants in all sorts of liveries, bringing and carrying messages between their masters and Monsieur de Tréville. In the antechamber, upon long circular benches, reposed the elect. That is to say, those who were called. In this apartment, a continued buzzing prevailed from morning till night, while Monsieur de Tréville, in his office contiguous to this antechamber, received visits, listened to complaints, gave his orders, and like the king in his balcony at the Louvre, had only to place himself at the window to review both his men and arms. The day on which D'Artagnan presented himself, the assemblage was imposing, particularly for a provincial just arriving from his province. It is true that this provincial was a Gascon, and that particularly at this period, the compatriots of D'Artagnan had the reputation of not being easily intimidated. When he had once passed the massive door, covered with long, square-headed nails, he fell into the midst of a troop of swordsmen, who crossed one another in their passage, calling out, quarreling, and playing tricks one with another. In order to make one's way amid these turbulent and conflicting waves, it was necessary to be an officer, a great noble, or a pretty woman. It was then into the midst of this tumult and disorder that our young man advanced with a beating heart, ranging his long rapier up his lanky leg, and keeping one hand on the edge of his cap with that half-smile of the embarrassed provincial who wishes to put on a good face. When he had passed one group, he began to breathe more freely, but he could not help observing that they turned round to look at him, and for the first time in his life, D'Artagnan, who had till that day entertained a very good opinion of himself, felt ridiculous. Arrived at the staircase, it was still worse. There were 4 musketeers on the bottom steps, amusing themselves with the following exercise, while 10 or 12 of their comrades waited upon the landing-place to take their turn in the sport. One of them, stationed upon the top stair, naked sword in hand, prevented, or at least endeavored to prevent, the 3 others from ascending. These 3 others fenced against him with their agile swords. D'Artagnan at first took these weapons for foils, and believed them to be buttoned. But he soon perceived, by certain scratches, that every weapon was pointed and sharpened, and that at each of these scratches not only the spectators, but even the actors themselves, laughed like so many madmen. He who at the moment occupied the upper step kept his adversaries marvelously in check. A circle was formed around them. The conditions required that at every hit the man touched should quit the game, yielding his turn for the benefit of the adversary who had hit him. In 5 minutes, 3 were slightly wounded, one on the hand, another on the ear, by the defender of the stair, who himself remained intact, a piece of skill which was worth to him, according to the rules agreed upon, 3 turns of favor. However difficult it might be, or rather, as he pretended it was, to astonish our young traveler, this pastime really astonished him. He had seen in his province, that land in which heads became so easily heated, a few of the preliminaries of duels, but the daring of these four fencers appeared to him the strongest he had ever heard of even in Gascony. He believed himself transported into that famous country of giants, into which Gulliver afterward went and was so frightened, and yet he had not gained the goal, for there were still the landing place and the antechamber. On the landing, they were no longer fighting, but amused themselves with stories about women, and in the antechamber, with stories about the court. On the landing, D'Artagnan blushed. In the antechamber, he trembled. His warm and fickle imagination, which in Gascony had rendered him formidable to young chambermaids, and even sometimes their mistresses, had never dreamed, even in moments of delirium, of half the amorous wonders or a quarter of the feats of gallantry which were here set forth, in connection with names the best known, and with details the least concealed. But if his morals were shocked on the landing, his respect for the cardinal was scandalized in the antechamber. There, to his great astonishment, D'Artagnan heard the policy which made all Europe tremble criticized, aloud and openly, as well as the private life of the cardinal, which so many great nobles had been punished for trying to pry into. That great man, who was so revered by D'Artagnan the elder, served as an object of ridicule to the musketeers of Tréville, who cracked their jokes upon his bandy legs and his crooked back. Some sang ballads about Mademoiselle D'Aguillon, his mistress, and Mademoiselle Cambalet, his niece, while others formed parties and plans to annoy the pages and guards of the Cardinal Duke, all things which appeared to D'Artagnan monstrous impossibilities. Nevertheless, when the name of the king was now and then uttered unthinkingly amid all these cardinal jests, a sort of gag seemed to close for a moment on all these jeering mouths. They looked hesitatingly around them, and appeared to doubt the thickness of the partition between them and the office of Monsieur de Tréville. But a fresh allusion soon brought back the conversation to his eminence, and then the laughter recovered its loudness, and the light was not withheld from any of his actions.
"Certes, these fellows will all either be imprisoned or hanged," thought the terrified D'Artagnan, "and I no doubt with them. For from the moment I have either listened or heard them, I shall be held as an accomplice. What would my good father say, who so strongly pointed out to me the respect due to the cardinal, if he knew I was in the society of such pagans?"
We have no need, therefore, to say that D'Artagnan dared not join in the conversation. Only he looked with all his eyes and listened with all his ears, stretching his five senses so as to lose nothing, and despite his confidence on the paternal admonitions, he felt himself carried by his tastes and led by his instincts to praise rather than to blame the unheard-of things which were taking place. Although he was a perfect stranger in the court of Monsieur de Tréville's courtiers, and this his first appearance in that place, he was at length noticed, and somebody came and asked him what he wanted. At this demand, D'Artagnan gave his name very modestly, emphasized the title of compatriot, and begged the servant who had put the question to him to request a moment's audience of Monsieur de Tréville, a request which the other, with an air of protection, promised to transmit in due season. D'Artagnan, a little recovered from his first surprise, had now leisure to study costumes and physiognomy. The center of the most animated group was a musketeer of great height and haughty countenance, dressed in a costume so peculiar as to attract general attention. He did not wear the uniform cloak, which was not obligatory at that epoch of less liberty but more independence, but a cerulean blue doublet, a little faded and worn, and over this a magnificent baldric, worked in gold, which shone like water ripples in the sun. A long cloak of crimson velvet fell in graceful folds from his shoulders, disclosing in front the splendid baldric, from which was suspended a gigantic rapier. This musketeer had just come off guard, complained of having a cold, and coughed from time to time affectedly. It was for this reason, as he said to those around him, that he had put on his cloak, and while he spoke with a lofty air and twisted his mustache disdainfully, all admired his embroidered baldric, and D'Artagnan more than anyone.
"What would you have?" said the musketeer, This fashion is coming in. It is a folly, I admit, but still, it is the fashion. Besides, one must lay out one's inheritance somehow.
Ah, Porthos, cried one of his companions. Don't try to make us believe you obtained that baldric by paternal generosity. It was given to you by that veiled lady I met you with the other Sunday, near the gate St. Honor.
No, upon my honor and by the faith of a gentleman, I bought it with the contents of my own purse,
answered he whom they designated by the name Porthos.
Yes, about in the same manner, said another musketeer, that I bought this new purse with what my mistress put into the old one.
It is true, though, said Porthos, and the proof is that I paid 12 pistoles for it.
The wonder was increased, though the doubt continued to exist.
Is it not true, Aramis?
Said Porthos, turning toward another musketeer. This other musketeer formed a perfect contrast to his interrogator, who had just designated him by the name of Aramis. He was a stout man of about 2 or 3 and 20, with an open, ingenuous countenance, a black, mild eye, and cheeks rosy and downy as an autumn peach. His delicate mustache marked a perfectly straight line upon his upper lip. He appeared to dread to lower his hands lest their veins should swell, and he pinched the tips of his ears from time to time to preserve their delicate pink transparency. Habitually, he spoke little and slowly, bowed frequently, laughed without noise, showing his teeth, which were fine, and of which, as the rest of his person, he appeared to take great care. He answered the appeal of his friend by an affirmative nod of the head. This affirmation appeared to dispel all doubts with regard to the baldric. They continued to admire it, but said no more about it, and with a rapid change of thought, the conversation passed suddenly to another subject.
"What do you think of the story Chalet's Esquire relates?"
asked another musketeer, without addressing anyone in particular, but on the contrary, speaking to everybody.
"And what does he say?"
asked Porthos in a self-sufficient tone.
"He relates that he met at Brussels Rochefort, the homme damné of the cardinal disguised as a capuchin, and that this cursed Rochefort, thanks to his disguise, had tricked Monsieur de Laigue like a ninny as he is."
"A ninny indeed," said Porthos. "But is the matter certain?"
"I had it from Aramis," replied the musketeer.
"Indeed?
Why, you knew it, Porthos," said Aramis. "I told you of it yesterday. Let us say no more about it."
"Say no more about it? That's your opinion," replied Porthos. "Say no more about it. Peste! You come to your own conclusions quickly. What? The cardinal sets a spy upon a gentleman, has his letters stolen from him by means of a traitor, a brigand, a rascal, has, with the help of this spy, and thanks to this correspondence, Chalet's throat cut, under the stupid pretext that he wants to kill the king and marry Monsieur to the queen. Nobody knew a word of this enigma. You unraveled it yesterday, to the great satisfaction of all, and while we are still gaping with wonder at the news, you come and tell us today. Let us say no more about it."
"Well, then, let us talk about it, since you desire it," replied Aramis patiently.
"This Rochefort," cried Porthos, "if I were the esquire of poor Chalet, should pass a minute or two very uncomfortably with me."
"And you would pass rather a sad quarter hour with the Red Duke," replied Aramis.
"Oh, the Red Duke! Bravo, bravo, the Red Duke!"
cried Porthos, clapping his hands and nodding his head.
"The Red Duke is capital. I'll circulate that saying, be assured, my dear fellow. Who says that Aramis is not a wit? What a misfortune it is you did not follow your first vocation. What a delicious abbé you would have made."
"Oh, it's only a temporary postponement," replied Aramis. I shall be one some day. You know very well, Porthos, that I continue to study theology for that purpose."
"He will be one, as he says," cried Porthos. "He will be one, sooner or later."
"Sooner," said Aramis.
"He only waits for one thing to determine him to resume his cassock, which hangs behind his uniform," said another musketeer.
"What is he waiting for?" asked another.
"Only till the queen has given an heir to the crown of France."
"No jesting upon that subject, gentlemen," said Porthos. "Thank God the queen is still of an age to give one."
"They say that Monsieur de Buckingham is in France," replied Aramis, with a significant smile which gave to this sentence, apparently so simple, a tolerably scandalous meaning.
"Aramis, my good friend, this time you are wrong," interrupted Porthos. "Your wit is always leading you beyond bounds. If Monsieur de Tréville heard you, you would repent of speaking thus."
"Are you going to give me a lesson, Porthos?" cried Aramis, from whose usually mild eye a flash passed like lightning.
"My dear fellow, be a musketeer or an abbé, be one or the other, but not both," replied Porthos. "You know what Athos told you the other day. You eat at everybody's mess. Ah, don't be angry, I beg of you. That would be useless. You know what is agreed upon between you, Athos, and me. You go to Madame d'Aguillon's, and you pay your court to her. You go to Madame de Bois-Tracy's, the cousin of Madame de Chevreuse, and you pass for being far advanced in the good graces of that lady. Oh, good Lord! Don't trouble yourself to reveal your good luck. No one asks for your secret. All the world knows your discretion. But since you possess that virtue, why the devil don't you make use of it with respect to Her Majesty? Let whoever likes to talk of the king and the cardinal, and how he likes, but the queen is sacred, and if anyone speaks of her, let it be respectfully."
"Porthos, you are as vain as Narcissus, I plainly tell you so," replied Aramis. "You know I hate moralizing, except when it is done by Athos. As to you, good sir, you wear too magnificent a baldric to be strong on that head. I will be an abbé if it suits me. In the meanwhile, I am a musketeer. In that quality, I say what I please, and at this moment it pleases me to say that you weary me."
"Aramis!"
"Porthos!"
"Gentlemen! Gentlemen!" cried the surrounding group. "Monsieur de Tréville awaits Monsieur d'Artagnan," cried a servant, throwing open the door to the cabinet. At this announcement, during which the door remained open, everyone became mute, and amid the general silence the young man crossed part of the length of the antechamber and entered the apartment of the captain of the musketeers, congratulating himself with all his heart at having so narrowly escaped the end of this strange quarrel. End of chapter 2. Recording by John Van Stan, Savannah, Georgia.
The Audience.
Monsieur de Tréville was at the moment in rather ill humor. Nevertheless, he saluted the young man politely, who bowed to the very ground, and he smiled on receiving D'Artagnan's response, the Béarnese accent of which recalled to him at the same time his youth and his country, a double remembrance which makes a man smile at all ages. But stepping toward the antechamber and making a sign to D'Artagnan with his hand, as if to ask his permission to finish with others before he began with him, he called three times, with a louder voice at each time, so that he ran through the intervening tones between the imperative accent and the angry accent.
"Athos! Porthos! Aramis!"
The two musketeers with whom we have already made acquaintance, and who answered to the last of these three names, immediately quitted the group of which they had formed a part, and advanced toward the cabinet, the door of which closed after them as soon as they had entered. Their appearance, although it was not quite at ease, excited by its carelessness, at once full of dignity and submission, the admiration of D'Artagnan, who beheld in these two men demigods, and their leader, an Olympian Jupiter, armed with all his thunders. When the two musketeers had entered, when the door was closed behind them, when the buzzing murmur of the antechamber, to which the summons which had been made had doubtless furnished fresh food, had recommenced, when Monsieur de Tréville had three or four times paced in silence, and with a frowning brow the whole length of his cabinet, passing each time before Porthos and Aramis, who were as upright and silent as if on parade, he stopped all at once full in front of them, and covering them from head to foot with an angry look.
"Do you know what the king said to me?" cried he, "and that no longer ago than yesterday evening. Do you know, gentlemen?"
"No," replied the two musketeers after a moment's silence.
"No, sir, we do not. But I hope that you will do us the honor to tell us,"
added Aramis in his politest tone and with his most graceful bow.
"He told me that he should henceforth recruit his musketeers from among the guards of Monsieur the Cardinal."
"The guards of the Cardinal? And why so?"
asked Porthos warmly.
"Because he plainly perceives that his piquette stands in need of being enlivened by a mixture of good wine."
Piquette is a watered liquor made from the second pressing of the grape. The two musketeers reddened to the whites of their eyes. D'Artagnan did not know where he was and wished himself 100 feet underground.
"Yes, yes,"
continued Monsieur de Tréville, growing warmer as he spoke,
"and his majesty was right, for upon my honor, it is true that the musketeers make but a miserable figure at court. The cardinal related yesterday, while playing with the king with an air of condolence very displeasing to me, that the day before yesterday those damned musketeers, those daredevils," he dwelt upon these words with an ironical tone still more displeasing to me, "those braggarts," added he, glancing at me with his tiger cat's eye, "had made a riot in the Rue Ferou in a cabaret, and that a party of his guards, I thought he was going to laugh in my face, had been forced to arrest the rioters. Morbleu, you must know something about it. Arrest musketeers. You were among them. You were. Don't deny it. You were recognized and the cardinal named you. But it's all my fault. Yes, it's all my fault. Because it is myself who selects my men. You, Aramis, why the devil did you ask me for a uniform when you would have been so much better in a cassock? And you, Porthos, do you only wear such a fine golden baldric to suspend a sword of straw from it? And Athos, I don't see Athos. Where is he?"
"Ill."
"Very ill, say you? And of what malady?"
"It is feared that it may be the smallpox, sir,"
replied Porthos, desirous of taking his turn in the conversation.
"And what is serious is that it will certainly spoil his face."
"The smallpox? That's a great story to tell me, Porthos. Sick of the smallpox at his age? No, no, but wounded without doubt. Killed, perhaps? If I knew. S'blood, messieurs musketeers, I will not have this haunting of bad places, this quarreling in the streets, this swordplay at the crossways, and above all, I will not have occasion given for the cardinal's guards, who are brave, quiet, skillful men, who never put themselves in a position to be arrested, and who, besides, never allow themselves to be arrested, to laugh at you. I am sure of it. They would prefer dying on the spot to being arrested or taking back a step. To save yourselves, to scamper away, to flee. That is good for the king's musketeers."
Porthos and Aramis trembled with rage. They could willingly have strangled Monsieur de Tréville if, at the bottom of all this, they had not felt it was the great love he bore them which made him speak thus. They stamped upon the carpet with their feet. They bit their lips till the blood came, and grasped the hilts of their swords with all their might. All without had heard, as we have said, Athos, Porthos, and Aramis called, and had guessed, from Monsieur de Tréville's tone of voice, that he was very angry about something. 10 curious heads were glued to the tapestry and became pale with fury, for their ears, closely applied to the door, did not lose a syllable of what he said, while their mouths repeated as he went on the insulting expressions of the captain to all the people in the antechamber. In an instant, from the door of the cabinet to the street gate, the whole hotel was boiling.
"Ah! The king's musketeers are arrested by the guards of the cardinal, are they?"
continued Monsieur de Tréville, as furious at heart as his soldiers, but emphasizing his words and plunging them one by one, so to say, like so many blows of a stiletto into the bosoms of his auditors.
"What! 6 of his eminence guards arrest 6 of his majesty's musketeers? Morbleu! My part is taken! I will go straight to the Louvre. I will give in my resignation as captain of the king's musketeers to take a lieutenancy in the cardinal's guards. And if he refuses me, morbleu, I will turn abbé."
At these words, the murmur without became an explosion. Nothing was to be heard but oaths and blasphemies. The morbleus, the sang dieus, the mort ou le diable crossed one another in the air. D'Artagnan looked for some tapestry behind which he might hide himself, and felt an immense inclination to crawl under the table.
"Well, my captain,"
said Porthos, quite beside himself,
"the truth is that we were 6 against 6, but we were not captured by fair means, and before we had time to draw our swords, 2 of our party were dead, and Athos, grievously wounded, was very little better. For you know Athos. Well, captain, he endeavored 2 to get up and fell again 2. And we did not surrender. No, no, they dragged us away by force. On the way we escaped. As for Athos, they believed him to be dead and left him very quiet on the field of battle, not thinking it worth the trouble to carry him away. That's the whole story. What the devil, captain? One cannot win all one's battles. The great Pompey lost that of Pharsalia. The Francis I, who was, as I have heard say, as good as other folks, nevertheless lost the Battle of Pavia.
And I have the honor of assuring you that I killed one of them with his own sword,"
said Aramis,
"for mine was broken at the first parry. Killed him, or poniarded him, sir, as is most agreeable to you."
"I did not know that," replied Monsieur de Tréville in a somewhat softened tone.
"The cardinal exaggerated, as I perceive."
"But pray, sir,"
continued Aramis, who, seeing his captain become appeased, ventured to risk a prayer,
"do not say that Athos is wounded. He would be in despair if that should come to the ears of the king. And as the wound is very serious, seeing that after crossing the shoulder it penetrates into the chest, it is to be feared."
At this instant the tapestry was raised, and a noble and handsome head, but frightfully pale, appeared under the fringe.
"Athos!"
cried the 2 musketeers.
"Athos!"
repeated Monsieur de Tréville himself.
"You have sent for me, sir,"
said Athos to Monsieur de Tréville in a feeble yet perfectly calm voice.
"You have sent for me, as my comrades inform me, and I have hastened to receive your orders. I am here. What do you want with me?"
And at these words the musketeer, in irreproachable costume, belted as usual with a tolerably firm step, entered the cabinet. Monsieur de Tréville, moved to the bottom of his heart by this proof of courage, sprang toward him.
"I was about to say to these gentlemen," added he, "that I forbid my musketeers to expose their lives needlessly, for brave men are very dear to the king, and the king knows that his musketeers are the bravest on the earth. Your hand, Athos."
And without waiting for the answer of the newcomer to this proof of affection, Monsieur de Tréville seized his right hand and pressed it with all his might, without perceiving that Athos, whatever might be his self-command, allowed a slight murmur of pain to escape him, and if possible, grew paler than he was before. The door had remained open, so strong was the excitement produced by the arrival of Athos, whose wound, though kept as a secret, was known to all. A burst of satisfaction hailed the last words of the captain, and two or three heads, carried away by the enthusiasm of the moment, appeared through the openings of the tapestry. Monsieur de Tréville was about to reprehend this breach of the rules of etiquette, when he felt the hand of Athos, who had rallied all his energies to contend against pain, at length overcome by it, fell upon the floor as if he were dead.
"A surgeon!" cried Monsieur de Tréville. "Mine! The king's! The best! A surgeon! Or, s'blood, my brave Athos will die!"
At the cries of Monsieur de Tréville, the whole assemblage rushed into the cabinet. He, not thinking to shut the door against anyone, and all crowded round the wounded man. But all this eager attention might have been useless if the doctor so loudly called for had not chanced to be in the hotel. He pushed through the crowd, approached Athos, still insensible, and as all this noise and commotion inconvenienced him greatly, he required, as the first and most urgent thing, that the musketeer should be carried into an adjoining chamber. Immediately, Monsieur de Tréville opened and pointed the way to Porthos and Aramis, who bore their comrade in their arms. Behind this group walked the surgeon, and behind the surgeon the door closed. The cabinet of Monsieur de Tréville, generally held so sacred, became in an instant the annex of the antechamber. Everyone spoke, harangued, and vociferated, swearing, cursing, and consigning the cardinal and his guards to all the devils. An instant after, Porthos and Aramis re-entered, the surgeon and Monsieur de Tréville alone remaining with the wounded. At length, Monsieur de Tréville himself returned. The injured man had recovered his senses. The surgeon declared that the situation of the musketeer had nothing in it to render his friends uneasy, his weakness having been purely and simply caused by loss of blood. Then Monsieur de Tréville made a sign with his hand, and all retired except D'Artagnan, who did not forget that he had an audience, and with the tenacity of a Gascon remained in his place. When all had gone out and the door was closed, Monsieur de Tréville, on turning round, found himself alone with the young man. The event which had occurred had in some degree broken the thread of his ideas. He inquired what was the will of his persevering visitor. D'Artagnan then repeated his name, and in an instant recovering all his remembrances of the present and the past, Monsieur de Tréville grasped the situation.
"Pardon me," said he, smiling. "Pardon me, my dear compatriot, but I had wholly forgotten you. But what help is there for it? A captain is nothing but a father of a family, charged with an even greater responsibility than the father of an ordinary family. Soldiers are big children. But as I maintain that the orders of the king, and more particularly, the orders of the cardinal, should be executed—"
D'Artagnan could not restrain a smile. By this smile, Monsieur de Tréville judged that he had not to deal with a fool, and changing the conversation, came straight to the point.
"I respected your father very much," said he. "What can I do for the son? Tell me quickly. My time is not my own."
"Monsieur," said D'Artagnan, "on quitting Tarbes and coming hither, it was my intention to request of you, in remembrance of the friendship which you have not forgotten, the uniform of a musketeer. But after all that I have seen during the last 2 hours, I comprehend that such a favor is enormous, and tremble lest I should not merit it."
"It is indeed a favor, young man," replied Monsieur de Tréville, "but it may not be so far beyond your hopes as you believe, or rather as you appear to believe, but His Majesty's decision is always necessary, and I inform you with regret that no one becomes a musketeer without the preliminary ordeal of several campaigns, certain brilliant actions, or a service of 2 years in some other regiment less favored than ours."
D'Artagnan bowed without replying, feeling his desire to don the musketeer's uniform vastly increased by the great difficulties which preceded the attainment of it.
"But,"
continued Monsieur de Tréville, fixing upon his compatriot a look so piercing that it might be said he wished to read the thoughts of his heart,
"on account of my old companion, your father, as I have said. I will do something for you, young man. Our recruits from Bayern are not generally very rich, and I have no reason to think matters have changed much in this respect since I left the province. I dare say you have not brought too large a stock of money with you."
D'Artagnan drew himself up with a proud air, which plainly said, "I ask alms of no man."
"Oh, that's very well, young man," continued Monsieur de Tréville. "That's all very well. I know these airs. I myself came to Paris with 4 crowns in my purse, and would have fought with anyone who dared to tell me I was not in a condition to purchase the Louvre."
D'Artagnan's bearing became still more imposing. Thanks to the sale of his horse, he commenced his career with 4 more crowns than Monsieur de Tréville possessed at the commencement of his.
"You ought, I say, then, to husband the means you have, however large the sum may be, but you ought also to endeavor to perfect yourself in the exercises becoming a gentleman. I will write a letter today to the director of the Royal Academy, and tomorrow he will admit you without any expense to yourself. Do not refuse this little service. Our best-born and richest gentlemen sometimes solicit it without being able to obtain it. You will learn horsemanship, swordsmanship in all its branches, and dancing. You will make some desirable acquaintances, and from time to time you can call upon me, just to tell me how you are getting on, and to say whether I can be of further service to you."
D'Artagnan, stranger as he was to all the manners of a court, could not but perceive a little coldness in this reception.
"Alas, sir," said he, "I cannot but perceive how sadly I missed the letter of introduction which my father gave me to present to you."
"I certainly am surprised," replied Monsieur de Tréville, "that you should undertake so long a journey without that necessary passport, the sole resource of us poor Bearnese."
"I had one, sir, and thank God, such as I could wish," cried D'Artagnan, "but it was perfidiously stolen from me."
He then related the adventure of Meung, described the unknown gentleman with the greatest minuteness, and all with a warmth and truthfulness that delighted Monsieur de Tréville.
"This is all very strange," said Monsieur de Tréville, after meditating a minute. "You mentioned my name, then aloud."
"Yes, sir, I certainly committed that imprudence, but why should I have done otherwise? A name like yours must be as a buckler to me on my way. Judge if I should not put myself under his protection."
Flattery was at that period very current, and Monsieur de Tréville loved incense as well as a king, or even a cardinal. He could not refrain from a smile of visible satisfaction, but this smile soon disappeared, and returning to the adventure of Meung,
"Tell me," continued he, "had not this gentleman a slight scar on his cheek?"
"Yes, such a one as would be made by the grazing of a ball."
"Was he not a fine-looking man?"
"Yes."
"Of lofty stature?"
"Yes."
"Of pale complexion and brown hair?"
"Yes, yes, that is he. How is it, sir, that you are acquainted with this man? If I ever find him again, and I will find him, I swear, were it in hell."
"He was waiting for a woman," continued Tréville.
"He departed immediately after having conversed for a minute with her whom he awaited."
"You know not the subject of their conversation."
"He gave her a box, told her not to open it except in London."
"Was this woman English?"
"He called her Milady."
"It is he. It must be he,"
murmured Tréville.
"I believed him still at Brussels."
"Oh, sir, if you know who this man is," cried D'Artagnan, "tell me who he is and whence he is. I will then release you from all your promises, even that of procuring my admission into the Musketeers, for before everything, I wish to avenge myself."
"Beware, young man," cried Tréville. "If you see him coming on one side of the street, pass by the other. Do not cast yourself against such a rock. he would break you like glass."
"That will not prevent me," replied D'Artagnan, "if I ever find him."
"In the meantime," said Tréville, "seek him not, if I have a right to advise you."
All at once the captain stopped, as if struck by a sudden suspicion. This great hatred which the young traveller manifested so loudly for this man, who, a rather improbable thing, had stolen his father's letter from him, was there not some perfidy concealed under this hatred? Might not this young man be sent by his eminence? Might he not have come for the purpose of laying a snare for him? This pretended D'Artagnan, was he not an emissary of the cardinal, whom the cardinal sought to introduce into Tréville's house, to place near him, to win his confidence, and afterward to ruin him, as had been done in 1,000 other instances? He fixed his eyes upon D'Artagnan even more earnestly than before. He was moderately reassured, however, by the aspect of that countenance, full of astute intelligence and affected humility.
"I know he is a Gascon," reflected he, "but he may be one for the cardinal as well as for me. Let us try him." "My friend," said he slowly, "I wish, as the son of an ancient friend, for I consider the story of the lost letter perfectly true, I wish, I say, in order to repair the coldness you may have remarked in my reception of you, to discover to you the secrets of our policy. The king and the cardinal are the best of friends. Their apparent bickerings are only feints to deceive fools. I am not willing that a compatriot, a handsome cavalier, a brave youth, quite fit to make his way, should become the dupe of all these artifices and fall into the snare after the example of so many others who have been ruined by it. Be assured that I am devoted to both these all-powerful masters, and that my earnest endeavors have no other aim than the service of the king and also the cardinal, one of the most illustrious geniuses that France has ever produced. Now, young man, regulate your conduct accordingly, and if you entertain, whether from your family, your relations, or even from your instincts, any of these enmities which we see constantly breaking out against the cardinal, bid me adieu and let us separate. I will aid you in many ways, but without attaching you to my person. I hope that my frankness, at least, will make you a friend, for you are the only young man to whom I have hitherto spoken as I have done to you."
Tréville said to himself,
"If the cardinal has set this young fox upon me, he will certainly not have failed. He who knows how bitterly I execrate him, to tell his spy that the best means of making his court to me is to rail at him. Therefore, in spite of all my protestations, if it be as I suspect, my cunning gossip will assure me that he holds his eminence in horror."
It, however, proved otherwise. D'Artagnan answered with the greatest simplicity, "I came to Paris with exactly such intentions. My father advised me to stoop to nobody but the king, the cardinal, and yourself, whom he considered the first three personages in France." D'Artagnan added Monsieur de Tréville to the others, as may be perceived, but he thought this addition would do no harm. "I have the greatest veneration for the cardinal," continued he, "and the most profound respect for his actions. So much the better for me, sir, if you speak to me as you say with frankness, for then you will do me the honor to esteem the resemblance of our opinions. But if you have entertained any doubt, as naturally you may, I feel that I am ruining myself by speaking the truth. But I still trust you will not esteem me for the less for it, and that is my object beyond all others." Monsieur de Tréville was surprised to the greatest degree. So much penetration, so much frankness, created admiration, but did not entirely remove his suspicions. The more this young man was superior to others, the more he was to be dreaded if he meant to deceive him. Nevertheless, he pressed D'Artagnan's hand and said to him,
"You are an honest youth, but at the present moment I can only do for you that which I just now offered. My hotel will be always open to you. Hereafter, being able to ask for me at all hours and consequently to take advantage of all opportunities, you will probably obtain that which you desire."
"That is to say," replied D'Artagnan, "that you will wait until I have proved myself worthy of it? Well, be assured," added he with the familiarity of a Gascon, "you shall not wait long." And he bowed in order to retire, and as if he considered the future in his own hands.
"But wait a minute," said Monsieur de Tréville, stopping him. "As I promised you a letter for the director of the academy, are you too proud to accept it, young gentleman?"
"No, sir," said D'Artagnan, "and I will guard it so carefully that I will be sworn it shall arrive at its address, and woe be to him who shall attempt to take it from me."
Monsieur de Tréville smiled at this flourish, and leaving this young man compatriot in the embrasure of the window, where they had talked together, he seated himself at a table in order to write the promised letter of recommendation. While he was doing this, D'Artagnan, having no better employment, amused himself with beating a march upon the window and with looking at the musketeers, who went away one after another, following them with his eyes until they disappeared. Monsieur de Tréville, after having written the letter, sealed it, and rising, approached the young man in order to give it to him. But at the very moment when D'Artagnan stretched out his hand to receive it, Monsieur de Tréville was highly astonished to see his protégé make a sudden spring, become crimson with passion, and rush from the cabinet, crying,
"S'blood! He shall not escape me this time!" "And who?"
asked Monsieur de Tréville.
"He, my thief!" replied D'Artagnan. "Ha! The traitor!"
And he disappeared.
"The devil take the madman," murmured Monsieur de Tréville. "Unless," added he, "this is a cunning mode of escaping, seeing that he had failed in his purpose."
End of chapter 3. Recording by John Van Stan, Savannah, Georgia.
Okay, so I have to confess. The first time I saw, heard, knew about the Three Musketeers was when I was a kid. And I must have gone with my parents to see the Three Musketeers in the theater because it was definitely larger than life in my brain. As a consequence, though, it is impossible for me to get both Michael York and Richard Chamberlain out of my head as D'Artagnan and as Aramis. I've watched a whole bunch of other versions of The Three Musketeers as a movie, and some of them are better than others. Some of them are more accurate to the book than others. But the reason why I bring this up is because, to me, Aramis is the hardest one to parse into our own day and time. He says, he will constantly say, that he is a religious man, that he is going to be an abbé, that this whole musketeer thing is just temporary. He's 23. That doesn't necessarily jibe with his prowess in fighting. It seems like an odd juxtaposition. But then he also does things like he doesn't want to put his hands down below the level of his heart or his waist because he doesn't want the veins to swell and make his hands look bad. So Richard Chamberlain, I think, really nails Aramis. If you're having a hard time kind of getting his character, Chamberlain, you buy that he can fight. I mean, there's a reason that he was like, what, the 1970s miniseries king. He's the Three Musketeers, Aramis. He's the Count of Monte Cristo, spectacular. He's Shogun. He just was kicking butt all during the 70s. So yeah, I had a hard time. I also have a hard time getting Oliver Reed out of my head as Athos, but we haven't seen a whole lot of Athos yet, aside from his stupendously cool entrance. Like, oh, he's got smallpox. Well, it's not really smallpox, but it's something. And they just don't want to fess up that he got wounded because dueling is illegal. And for him to walk through the door and be like, no, 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 it's all right. I'm here, yo. And then have Treville shake his hand and go, oh, it's just kind of awesome. You will also find out, I think next week, that there is a real reason for why Porthos was behaving the strange way that he was, where he was swinging his cape around really meaningfully and saying that he had sniffles and that's why he was wearing the cloak while he was showing off this fabulous golden baldric, the kind of Miss America sash that had all the embroidery on it, but was also what you would use to hold your sword. There is a reason for it, and it will make you laugh. I also loved at the beginning of chapter two how how Dumas describes, like, the king's like, okay, I've got this Treville guy, and he's a stand-up dude I can trust, so I'm going to have him be in charge of my dudes who will be fighting for me and protecting me. And so the cardinal's like, oh, well, that sounds like a pretty good idea. Maybe I should get a gang too, and mine are going to be better than yours and have better uniforms. And it's just like roosters strutting around each other, trying to get a peck in anytime they can, but also just constantly fluffing themselves up like, no, 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 mine are better than yours. And poor D'Artagnan is it's like the new kid at school, having gone through the cafeteria line and standing there holding his tray, trying to figure out where it's safe to sit at lunch because all of the musketeers appear to be crazy people. And what do you do? And what does he do? He just stands around and waits for somebody to notice him and go, oh, you had an appointment, right? So at the end of the chapters today, Treville is not wrong to be cautious about D'Artagnan's motives, why he has appeared without a letter. And some of that is because when Dumas was giving us all the rumors and the gossip and the intrigue, both about the cardinal and then Milady and Rochefort, a lot of the rumors and gossip that he was sharing were true for the time. In fact, the rumors and gossip were accurate for everyone except for Milady, who wasn't real, and Rochefort, who's kind of a pastiche of a bunch of different people, but not really a real-to-life person like Richelieu, the king, Treville, Queen Anne, who we're going to meet soon, people like that. All right, I think that's it. Oh, except we also have a TikTok channel now, because Eric's awesome. It is, I know this is shocking, TikTok.com/@CraftLit. Huh? All right, that's it now. You have a great rest of your week and have a great one. Be well. I'll talk to you soon. Bye. A big thanks to all the CraftLit listeners who support the show by being a premium audio member via craftlit.com/premium or via patreon.com/craftlit. Your support for the show is what's kept us going since 2006. If you feel like getting free audio pretty much every week, please consider supporting the show by heading over to patreon.com/craftlit and pledging what you feel the show is worth to you. If you can't support the show that way, consider leaving a review at iTunes or at our facebook.com/craftlit page, or follow @craftlit on Twitter and share the show with your followers too. And remember, if your hands are too busy to pick up a book, at least you can turn one on.